Okay.
All right.
All right. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming to our seminar. It's a pleasure to have here today Dr. Dmitry Morozov from Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. Dmitry is actually sort of one of our own. He was an undergraduate actually here at NC State in applied math and in computer science, and then went on to Duke to get his PhD in computer science from the computer science department. He was a postdoctoral scholar in the math department and the computer science department at Stanford University. And following that, he's where he's at now, at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab. He's been doing a lot of work in big data analysis, and in particular, this whole area of algebraic topology applied to data analysis. And it's a pleasure to have him here. Thank you. The floor is yours.
Okay. Okay, well, first of all, Hamid, thank you for the invitation. It's really a delight for me to be back and tell you a little bit about my work. So suppose I ask you what the highest mountain is in the world. Hey, what is the highest mountain in the world?
The Appalachian.
Yeah. Only North Carolina get this answer. Well, I assume the rest of you will tell me Mount Everest, right? Here it is. 8,850 meters. Now, suppose I ask you what the 10 highest mountains are in the world. Who can name the 10 highest mountains? Yeah, neither could I. So
you have it on your phone. So, you know, within 5 seconds, you can find
it. Yeah, that's exactly actually what I did. I just went to the Wikipedia because, you know, it's there. It's getting cut off, but hopefully it will be okay. So, number four on this list, Lhotse, is actually this peak right next to Everest. Its height is just over 8,500 meters. But what interests me is not Lhotse, but the peak next to it, called Lhotse Shar. Now, Lhotse Shar is just shy of 8,400 meters, which in particular places it higher than this Mount Chooyu, which is roughly 8,200 meters. But it's not on this list, and it's not a mistake, right? So here's the puzzle for you. Why is this clearly higher peak than you know, already number six, not on the list? Well, I think the intuitive answer should be pretty obvious, right? It's somehow we don't think of it as a separate mountain. We don't think of it as being important enough, but really we think of it as part of Lhotse. But how to make this formal? And the way this is done is in mountaineering, there's this concept of topographic prominence, which says roughly the following, that if you want to describe the prominence of a peak, you start at the peak, and then you go down to the first contour that encloses something higher than this than our peak. So in this case, if we start here, we go down just a little bit, and we find a contour that will enclose a higher peak. So the prominence of this peak in the middle is this small number, whereas this small difference in height. Whereas this peak, we have to go further down to enclose, you know, yet another higher peak, and so forth. And that's the description. So in the previous picture, of course, you can think this is Everest, this is Lhotse, and this is Lhotse Shar. And it's convenient to record this information in a plane in what we call a persistence diagram, namely, on the vertical axis, you record the maximum of the peak. On the horizontal axis, you record the saddle, the value of the saddle. And so now the prominence is simply the distance of a point to the diagonal, the vertical distance to the diagonal, the difference between the two. Right? And looking at this diagram, you can tell, right? There is a sort of small unimportant point, small sort of wrinkle, a slightly bigger mountain, and even bigger mountain over here. That's the way you would interpret this. And so now we can do this for the entire planet. Except if I were to do it for the entire planet, my PDF viewer would crash, so I removed points with prominence less than 2,800 meters. And now what's actually going on, right? So when you ask for the highest mountains, you're really asking for the points that are like the highest in this diagram. Except that if you actually look on Wikipedia, what it tells you is it only tells you mountains with prominence greater than 500 meters. And so what it does is it reports, here's Mount Everest, here's K2, there's Lhotse, but Lhotse Shar simply didn't make the cutoff. And it's very fortunate that this cutoff is in place because, for example, the southern summit of Mount Everest would be higher than everything else, but it sits somewhere here. Its prominence is something like 10 meters. So it's just a small wrinkle. And if you take this to sort of to its logical conclusion, then every bump, every rock, every little sort of wrinkle on Everest would be higher than pretty much anything else. So that's sort of the reason for these cutoffs. But of course, when you have this kind of representation, you can ask other questions. Like, you don't have to ask for what are the highest mountains, but you can ask what are the most prominent mountains. So here's the list. And this is really what I'm asking is, tell me what are the points that are furthest away from the diagonal. And here you suddenly get lots of familiar sort of usual suspects, right? You get Mount Everest, you get Mount McKinley, the highest point in North America, Kilimanjaro in Africa, and most of these, Mount Elbrus in Europe. You really pick up the prominent mountains, the ones that stand out. They match up with the highest points of some kind of geographical entity that we understand. Okay, so what is actually going on? Sort of let's now formalize and generalize things a little bit. And to do that, I need to introduce a concept from algebraic topology called homology. An homology is really a way to describe connectivity of a space. And so it's a rather coarse description of connectivity of a space. A homology group is, for this talk, we will only work over fields, is really a vector space, and it captures the number of non-bounding cycles. So the zero-dimensional homology group captures the number of components. One-dimensional homology group captures the number of loops. Two-dimensional homology group captures the number of voids. So in this example, and Betty number, so this beta P is really the rank of the homology group. So in this example, we have a space with three components. So its Betty 0 is 3, and all the higher dimensional Betty numbers are 0. If we take an annulus, its Betty 0 is 1, its Betty 1 is 1, because Betty 0 is 1 because it has one component, its Betty 1 is 1 because it has this hole, right? If we take a torus, then its Betty 0 is going to be 1, it has one connected component. Its Betty 1 is going to be 2, there are two independent cycles. There's a cycle that goes around this way and this way. We'll look at this in a second. And Betty 2 is 1 because there is a void. There is an inside to the torus and an outside. And this inside is what the Betty 2 captures. So let's sort of zoom in on the torus. So one cycle is this blue guy. Now if we take another cycle here, it's actually in the same homology class because they bound this green cylinder. Another example of a cycle here would be a red cycle that goes around the hole. So these are the two cycles that span the entire homology group. As an example, there's another cycle here, but this guy is really a boundary of this cap, and so in homology it's a zero element. It represents the zero element. Yeah. Okay, well we can see what happens to homology as we filter the space, meaning as we grow the space. So if we start with a space Y1, then we grow it into a space it includes into a space Y2, into Y3, Y4, and so forth. If we have such a filtration of spaces, then we can keep track of what happens to the homology groups. And namely, these inclusions, they induce linear maps on homology groups. So if we took a cycle that formed the one cycle that formed here, we can keep track of it where it lives in the homology group of later spaces. And this information is actually what's being captured by these persistence diagrams. What sort of when I was describing these wrinkles on Everest, it's really this kind of information. And sort of let me explain this a little bit. So if we have, this is our filtration of spaces. There are maps, or there are homology groups associated to every space, and there are linear maps that they induced on them. And if you have such a sequence of vector spaces connected by linear maps, you can pick a basis for each one of them in a way where the linear maps really become diagonal. So if you take an element that corresponds to this basis element, it will map into the basis element here, which will map into the basis element here. And so in this picture, you have in H0, for the components, you have a class that goes from space Y1 all the way to Y5. We have a one-dimensional cycle born here that lasts until the very end. And we have a one-dimensional cycle that appears in Y4 that very quickly dies. That's the information contained in the sequence. No? Okay. So where do such... And computationally, in order to do this, it's a really a linear algebra. It's a bookkeeping algorithm to figure out where different classes appear and then disappear. You keep track of kernels and co-kernels in the sequence. Okay, so where do these filtrations come from? Because obviously, I mean, depending on what your filtration is, you get different answers. And sort of a standard source of these filtrations is if you're given a real-valued function, so a function from some space X into R, and now you can look at the sublevel sets of this function. So you can start filtering from the bottom up and see how the sublevel sets are changing and how the homology groups are changing. So in this case, as we pass a minimum, a component is born. We keep going. As we pass another minimum, another component is born. As we keep going, yet another component is born. And now when this component merge, we say that in order to get this kind of decomposition that I showed on the previous slide, it turns out there's a simple rule that just says that when two components merge, the younger guy dies. So the one that appeared later on is the one that disappears. And so we get this pair A3, A4. Now as we pass the maximum here at A5, the younger guy, so A2 got merged into A1. So we get a pair A2, A5. And finally, A1 survives until infinity, so we have A1 infinity pair. And this is exactly the information that we record in the persistence diagram. So except now I flipped the function, right? When I was talking about Everest, I was talking about maxima, I was talking about wrinkles on top, and here I'm really talking about the valleys, if you will. Okay, so this is a rather interesting object. A few things about it. So if we're interested in the kind of information that is contained in the persistence diagram, we can ask, for example, the question is, what is the rank of the homology group that goes from the sublevel set B to the sublevel set C? What is the rank of this map? Namely, how many classes that are born before B survive until C? Right? And to read this information off from the persistence diagram, you simply look at the classes that are born before B. So on the horizontal axis, we record the birth. And we look at the classes that die after C. And so the intersection is really just the quadrant. And that's exactly, so you get two points here, which corresponds exactly to, we have really three components in the sublevel set of C, but only two of them came from before B. That's the information. Now, persistence diagrams have one rather useful property one technical detail. I need, sort of, when I record the persistence diagram, I record these points that I described, and I also add all the points on the diagonal with infinite multiplicity. This will become clear why this is necessary in a second. So here's the question: what happens if we perturb the function a little bit? So we took some kind of a perturbation. We added lots and lots of little wrinkles. Well, what you can see is that all these wrinkles, they became points along the diagonal. The by and large, the points that were far away, they haven't changed. They just moved a little bit. Here's a picture. So this red point matches this blue point, this red point matches this blue point, this red point, and then lots of noise. Which is a statement that we can actually make formal, but we need an auxiliary concept of bottleneck distance. If we have two point sets, we can measure the distance between them using bottleneck distance, which means that we will find a matching between these two point sets that will minimize the length of the longest edge. So in this case, we match up the points as I described, and all of these little noisy points match to the diagonal, which is why I said that we needed to take it with infinite multiplicity. And now there is a celebrated result that sort of, well, justifies, motivates, however you want to put it, a lot of work in this area, which says that persistence diagrams are stable. Namely, if you take two functions that are epsilon apart from each other, so the blue guy is a perturbation of the red guy, then their persistence diagrams are going to be close in the bottleneck distance. So the blue diagram is just a perturbation of the red diagram. Yeah, seems believable. Very good. Okay, one more example, and we move on. So of course the reason we talk about homology is that we can do this not just for keeping track of components, but for higher dimensional features. And so here's the torus. The function on it will be the height function. So we're filtering from the bottom up. And now let's do the filtration. As we pass a minimum, a component is born. As we pass another minimum, another component is born. They merge together at the settle. So now the younger guy died, which is this little interval. Now as we keep going, as we pass this settle, the sublevel set now looks like a cylinder. So it has a one-dimensional homology class. That's what happened here. And we keep going. Another one-dimensional homology class is born, now this time around the hole. Yet another one-dimensional homology class is born as we pass this settle, but it gets capped off very quickly by this maximum. And so there is a short interval in the one-dimensional homology, and finally as we pass the maximum, the entire torus appears, and so we get the two-dimensional homology class. And so this is just an alternative representation for the diagram, is that we have a small wrinkle corresponds to this interval, another small wrinkle corresponds to this interval, and now you will notice that the classes that survive to infinity is exactly the homology of the domain. So the torus, remember, we said has Betty 0 is equal to 1, Betty 1 equals to 2, Betty 2 equals to 1. And this is exactly, we have one infinite interval in dimension 0, 2 in dimension 1, and 1 in dimension 2. Okay, some intuition, right, for persistence. Okay, and so now if you have this description, if you have these persistence diagrams, you can start asking questions, like some very initial questions. For example, if I give you a function f, and I give you some threshold epsilon, you take the persistence diagram of f, and now I really ask you to find me a function g that is epsilon close to the original function, so that all of these noisy wrinkles are gone. This is suddenly a question that you can, well, one, pose. It's sort of a well-posed question. And two, you can actually answer this question, right? And so it's a kind of a simplification question. And this is useful if you imagine your function to be, for example, an image, and you want to do some kind of watershed method for partitioning it for segmenting it into regions. You want to get rid of the local maxima or local minima that will get you stuck. And this is a way to get rid of this extrema. So here's really the question is that I have some function, I have a threshold epsilon, and now I really want to find a function that looks like this, right? That sort of straightens out all the small wrinkles but keeps all the big ones in place. This is, you can imagine this is a useful question, and this question has a positive answer. And not only can you do this, but you can do this in linear time, but only for extrema, which is unfortunate, but it's the case. Notice that this is, of course, in electrical engineering, everybody's familiar with things like low-pass filters. This is a very differently, sort of, I mean, there is, of course, a similarity, but there is a much, much more precise control over what happens to critical points. So this is like a topology-aware filtering. Now, this may not seem terribly, you know, maybe impressive that you can do this, that you can do this kind of simplification for extrema until you realize that actually if I ask you to simplify higher dimensional features, like the one cycles, it's actually impossible. There are domains, such as the Poincaré sphere, on which any function you pick, I can give you an epsilon high enough to where if you were to, you basically cannot simplify the function for that epsilon. And maybe I skip the proof because time is running. Okay, so I've said that, you know, you can compute persistence for any filtration, and the filtrations come from functions. So what are these interesting functions? And one interesting function is the distance function, and the way to motivate it is as follows. Suppose I give you a point set that looks like this. And I now ask you, what is the homology of this point set? What is the shape of this point set? Well, this question is not actually terribly sort of meaningful because the point set just consists of lots of points. So its homology has whatever is the number of components is equal to the number of points, but the things that you're seeing, the circle and the little loops, of course, these are not captured in ordinary homology. But now, if we sort of squint our eyes, and then we squint them a little more and a little more, we start seeing different features, right? You start seeing in the gray subwell, so you start seeing the little loops. So what we're actually doing is we're looking at the distance function to this point cloud. So in other words, this is the function that at every point of the space records the distance to the closest point of the point cloud. And now the sublevel sets, if you think about what is the sublevel set of the distance function, this is really a union of balls. Because the points that are at distance at most r, at most alpha, from the point cloud is exactly the union of balls of radius alpha centered on the point cloud. Yeah? And so you can apply the same machinery, you can compute homology, and here's the persistence diagram. And the persistence diagram has one prominent point, which corresponds to the entire circle, and, well, there are 10 points here which correspond to these little links. Which, of course, I've sampled these points from some ideal underlying space, this blue curve, which has exactly this. Its homology is one-dimensional homology. It has one big cycle, and it has 10 small cycles corresponding to these points. And you can tell that this is really the consequence of the stability theorem that, or we will tell in a second, this is a consequence of stability theorem the information that we get from the sampling of the function of the space recovers information about the underlying space. So how do we prove this? Well, we need a condition on our sampling, and namely we say that a point set has a Hausdorff distance of epsilon to two spaces have Hausdorff distance epsilon if for every point of one set you can find a point of another set at a distance of epsilon, and vice versa. In other words, if I take this figure 8 and I thicken it by epsilon, it will contain all the points. And vice versa, if I take the points and I thicken them by epsilon, they will contain the figure 8. So if this is true, then the two point sets are epsilon close to each other. And now, if this holds, you can verify this in a moment's thought, that if the two point sets are epsilon close to each other, then their distance functions are going to be epsilon apart. It's a consequence of a triangle inequality. And now you can see that, you know, this begs for stability theorem. If we filter one space and we get its persistence diagram, now what does the persistence diagram of this ideal space look like? Well, the ideal space has two one-dimensional cycles, right? This is one, this is another one, and they're both born at zero. They all exist, I mean, they exist in the space, which means that they exist in the zeroth level set, which means that they're born at zero, which means that they appear on this vertical axis, and then they die at some point. Except that I need one assumption on the space. I need to assume that it's well conditioned, that its smallest positive critical value is some number, we call it the weak feature size, which is you know, the first time that the homology of Y changes. And in this case, it's pretty large, right? It's the first time the homology of these sublevel sets changes is actually when this loop dies. So the value inside of here is going to be the weak feature size. And if you assume that if you have the information about the weak feature size, then you know exactly what the persistence diagram of the distance function to the space is going to look like. Since there are no changes to homology between zero and the weak feature size, you know that there are not going to be any birth in this region, there are not going to be any deaths in this region, which means that you have points here and you have points here in the persistence diagram. Well, now the rest is just mechanics, right? If you take a point set, you compute its persistence diagram, it's going to look like this, and it's going to be close to the persistence diagram of the original shape. And now you can just use stability theorem that will tell you that the persistence diagram of the distance function to the point set is going to have some points in this quadrant. This is this red line that came out by epsilon. This sort of triangular region will expand by epsilon, and the diagonal will come out. And since these two regions don't intersect, you know that the number of points in this quadrant, namely epsilon 3 epsilon, is going to be exactly the number of points that were on the vertical, on the zero axis for the original space. Okay, let's see who is with me. So I've sampled a bunch of points. I've computed their persistence diagrams. This is the 0, 1, and 2-dimensional persistence diagrams. What space did they sample?
Torus.
Very, very, very good. There it is. Okay, so a few people are awake, so, you know, yeah. Good. Does everybody sort of see what I'm talking about, right? That the ideal diagram for the torus would look like we would have a point in zero dimensions on this axis, two points here, one point here. But now, because we don't have the ideal space, but we have a sampling, you have something that's close, but not exactly the same.
Right. But what's the U here?
Sorry?
U is the torus?
The U would be, the point set is this. The point set is the underlying space is the torus itself. Yeah. So I've sampled these points to lie on the torus, although this is a two-dimensional projection, so you can't tell. But you know, take my word for it.
So it's reversely engineered. You started with the U, say.
Say again, sorry?
You started with the torus, with an actual torus.
Well, the algorithm started with the point cloud. But I started with the torus
and
to
the
sample to make the point cloud. That's right. To, you know, to make a point.
You're not supposed to know that.
No, you are supposed to. That's exactly what you're supposed to know. I mean, I know what the ideal space is here, and I recovered it, you know. Hooray.
No, but what I'm saying in general, you have
right,
observed,
in general, right.
You have observed the point cloud, and you're supposed to infer.
We'll get there in a second. Okay, so maybe there is some question in your mind of how you actually do this. I've said nothing about the algorithms, and actually I won't, but which is, you know. Anyway, so how do you represent this sort of the distance function? We said the sublevel sets of the distance function to the point cloud is really a union of balls. So how do you represent this on a computer? I mean, this is a continuous shape. And there are standard constructions that people use. There are alpha shapes, check, Vietori strips complexes. So maybe check complex is the easiest to describe. We look at our balls, and we look at the intersection pattern. Anytime two balls intersect, we place an edge. Anytime three balls intersect, we place a triangle. Four balls, we place a tetrahedron. And so we get this implicit complex, which is a generalization of a triangulation, that for this set of balls looks like this. It's, you know, we have a triangle here because these three balls intersect. We have an edge here because these balls intersect, and so forth. And there are classical results from algebraic topology that tell you that the topology of this simplicial complex captures the topology of this union of balls. And you can see this, right? The union of balls has two holes, and so does the simplicial complex. There are other popular constructions, for example, Vieturi-Strips complex, which looks at all those points that have lie within pairwise distance of r from each other, r over 2 from each other, and then it finds all the cliques in this graph. So you get this nearest neighbor graph, and now you find all the cliques in it, which is, you know, a construction, because how do you test when balls intersect? I mean, this is not actually a trivial problem. Whereas finding cliques in the graph is, well, something you learn in, you know, an undergraduate class. The trouble is that the Vieturi-Strips complex is not exactly equal to the homology of the underlying space, but it turns out you can prove that the persistent homology, for now I do, instead of filtering the union of balls, I filter the simplicial complex, I increase this radius r, I will get something, the persistence diagrams are going to be close. Take my word for it. Okay. So what can we do? So why is it useful to infer homology of a space, right? I mean, sort of besides pure intellectual curiosity and you know, all the pure reasons that our math colleagues enjoy. So here's the motivation for you. Suppose you're given, there is, you know, in machine learning, there is this, of course, the classical semi-supervised learning problem. So you're given a bunch of points, so think of each point as a clinical trial or a protein or something on which you want to compute statistics. And a few of these are labeled. So maybe a clinician, you know, studied the clinical trial and assigned some label to it. And now all you want to do is you want to propagate these labels. So the question is, how can you take advantage of the unlabeled data? Because if you don't take advantage of the unlabeled data, you know, a reasonable scheme is to say, you give me a point, I will just assign to it the label of my nearest neighbor. Which means that the assignment will look like this. But when you map it onto on this point set, well, maybe this is a reasonable assignment. I don't know. But these points also get sort of strange colors. But maybe it's also useful to know that there is this kind of assignment, where I take the intrinsic structure of the point set into account, and now I propagate the labels not based on the extrinsic distance between the points, but based on the intrinsic distance within the space. I don't know whether this is the right answer, but at least it's useful to know that there are alternatives, and it's useful to be able to find these alternatives. And in this context, people talk about, sometimes people call this the manifold learning problem, people talk about nonlinear dimensionality reduction, and so forth. And the way I want to think about dimensionality reduction is really that the way we understand data is we understand it by finding maps into some kind of simpler spaces that we can get our hands on. So, you know, everybody's favorite principal component analysis really finds a map into a linear subspace that somehow captures the most variance of the point cloud, given some fixed dimension. Or clustering, you can think of it that you find maps from your point set into points that satisfy some kind of properties. When people talk about nonlinear dimensionality reduction, like isomap or LLE, what they mean by nonlinear is that the domain, the source of the points, is nonlinear. So there is some kind of a shape that sits in some kind of high-dimensional space. But the target space of such maps is usually Euclidean space. So if our ordinary linear, like isomap, for example, takes some kind of a nearest neighbor graph on a point cloud, and then it finds an embedding into Euclidean space that somehow preserves the intrinsic distances within this graph. That's your isomap that, you know, everybody knows and loves. But of course, it's reasonable to ask for other kinds of maps. You can ask for, if you're working, for example, with periodic data and you expect cycles in it, it's reasonable to ask for maps into circles. Or, you know, if you were talking about phase coordinates, again, they're naturally parametrized by circles, which if you were to map into Euclidean space, you would need two coordinates as opposed to just, you know, the one intrinsic coordinate. And this is where homology can come to be of some use. So instead of homology, I'll need cohomology, but this is not terribly important at this level. The point is that the persistence diagrams will be the same. And there is a classical result from algebraic topology that says that the one-dimensional cohomology group, so this is, the cohomology is a vector space dual of homology. So instead of having a cycle, which is a collection of edges, we have maps from edges into integers, for example. And there is a statement that the first cohomology group over integers is isomorphic to the homotopy classes of maps from the space into the circle. Because if you I used to thinking only about maps into Euclidean space. Now there's nothing, this issue doesn't come up at all. There is only all maps, you can be continuously transformed from one to another because the space is contractible. But now if you're thinking about maps to a circle, imagine taking a torus. I can map a torus into a circle by going around the hole, or I can wind laterally. And you cannot transform one map into the other one continuously. So this issue starts appearing, but the point is that the cohomology can help us resolve it. And so here's a very simple algorithm. We take some point cloud, we compute its persistent cohomology classes. There you go. So here's a point cloud. It's one-dimensional persistence diagram because it's just a circle, has one prominent point and lots of noise. We turn each one, we take a class, for example, this class, and we turn it into a map, into a circle in accordance with this isomorphism. And this map really looks like it maps all the vertices to zero, and then it winds the edges around the circle with a degree prescribed by the cohomology class. This is a rather difficult to interpret map. I mean, all points map to one point. It's not terribly helpful. But then you can smooth. It's an entire class of maps, and so you can ask for the smoothest map in this class. So you can somehow spread the points out around the circle, and you get a picture that looks like this. You get so the colors here describe really the map that you get from your points to the circle, and in this case you recover perfectly the coordinate, the original parameterization. So maybe it's easier to just look at a few examples to get a sense for. So here's what we just saw. Here is a circle. We take this cohomology class. The cohomology class corresponding to this point, and we get a nice smooth parameterization that goes around the circle. And now if we were to pick one of these noisy points, well, what we really get is a parameterization around some kind of a tiny feature inside, because this is these points, they come from little cycles that form and quickly die in our filtration. All right, maybe here's another example. So we take a trefoil knot that sits in R3. We compute this persistence diagram. There it is. We take the most prominent point. We compute the parameterization, and it recovers exactly the parameterization that generated the trefoil knot. And in fact, we can correlate, because again, I knew how this got sampled. We can correlate the recovered parameterization to the original parameterization, and it's not perfect. It's noisy, but it gets there. So here's what I was saying about the torus. If you have a bunch of points on the torus, you have two prominent points that correspond to the homology of the torus. And if you parameterize with respect to one of them, you get a nice parameterization that goes this way. So here it's your one prominent class of maps. And the other one, which, well, it's hard to tell, it goes laterally, it goes sort of inside out around the torus. Makes sense? And so it's a way of finding maps from point clouds into circles. Maybe another example. So here we have two circles that are joined together. They have two points. You parameterize with respect to one, and you really have something that maps, this circle onto the left circle onto the circle, and squeezes everything here to a point. And the other map maps this circle to around the circle and squeezes everything here to a point. And you can look at the sort of you can plot. So this is now a picture on the torus. I plot for each point its coordinates with respect to one and with respect to the other map. And so in this conjoint circle case, I get two maps that are almost orthogonal to each other, bar the noise, versus on the torus, I get exactly parameterization over the entire torus. So you can, even though you cannot distinguish them by one-dimensional homology, you can distinguish these two objects by by what their maps look like. Maybe convoluted example. So here are 72 images of Lucky Cat, this Chinese doll. We treat each, so it's, each one is a grayscale image. I mean, these are actual, honest to goodness pictures. Each one is 128 by 128 pixels. We vectorize it. We treat it as a point in the R128 squared, or the large space. Now we build a Vitura strips complex on it, compute its persistence diagram. There it is. There is one point that sticks out. This is a one-dimensional diagram. And now we can just do an entire pipeline that I just described with respect to this point. And what you recover is this rotation of the cat around its sort of vertical axis, which Granted, I cheated. I took a point set. I mean, I took pictures that were generated by rotating the cat around it. So, but at least we recovered it from starting from the point. So it's, you know, yeah. Anyway.
How did you actually calculate those things? I mean,
this. So this is I took each point, I treated as a point in R128 squared, and now I just take Euclidean distance in the space as my metric. Now I build the Vitor strips complex, which is this: you build this nearest neighbor graph. So as I increase my filtration radius, I build larger and larger nearest neighbor graph, and I find all the clicks in this graph. And then at some
Because, I mean, the way how you illustrate the results, it seems quite simple, but I'm imagining that it was quite complicated to do.
This particular example, it wasn't, but it's okay. True that I tried to generate something else where I sort of ran into some trouble. It's true, I'm sweeping a great deal under the rug, but
yeah.
Finding this diagram is not the thing that I'm sweeping under the rug. Yeah. There is a lot of magic. I mean, I won't deny that this sort of works nicely in some cases, it doesn't work so well in other cases.
Yeah,
but
that's understandable.
Right, but the point is that there's a great deal of data, like periodic data, where the natural parameterizations are circled, and you really it doesn't make sense to map them into Euclidean spaces when you really want something that lives on Torii, right? Okay, so slightly shifting gears, I imagine you can have lots of objections to this, to everything I've said so far, but one objection that certainly I had for the longest time is that this model of noise, this Hausdorff noise, is a very unrealistic kind of model, because it really says that my points lie close to some true underlying space, and close in this very strong sense that every point is epsilon away and vice versa. And so it's desirable to move from, but of course it's precisely this model of noise that gives us this condition that the two distance functions are going to be close, and therefore we can apply all this machinery of stability in order to infer homology, for example. And it's of course extremely desirable to move into sort of a more general setting. So instead of talking about compact sets, we really want to talk about probability measures. And instead of sort of talking about a very tight Hausdorff sort of sampling, you really want to draw points from these probability measures. And in particular, I want to move from talking about Hausdorff distance to talking about Wasserstein distance. So this is sometimes called Earth mover's distance. It's a way to measure distance between two probability distributions, where you can think of it as that you place some amount of dirt, Earth, onto each point, and then you try to move it onto the other distribution in the most optimal way. Yeah, intuitively makes sense. Very good. But the question is sort of, now if I give you a point set that looks like this, can you recover some information? Can you tell me that the underlying, what I really sampled it from, was a distribution that was concentrated on this figure 8? So certainly distance functions won't work here, because if you look at this, there are points that completely cover up the whole. So there is no hope for the distance function. But there is a solution. And the solution is the following. So I start with a point set P that sits in some Euclidean space, and I fix a parameter K, and I'll come back to how I get this parameter K. And now for each point P, I look at its K nearest neighbors. And I replace this point P with a point at the barycenter of these k nearest neighbors, except I lift it into one dimension higher by the weight that is the sum, this should be a square root here, the and 1 over k, but basically by the root mean square distance to this k nearest neighbors from the barycenter. So again, take a point, find its k nearest neighbors, move it to the barycenter, and then lift it into Rg plus 1. So the first part of the step, if you're familiar with the mean shift procedure, this is exactly the mean shift. You take a point, you move it to its k nearest neighbors. But this lifting into the one space, one dimension higher, is sort of what does the trick. And so now, instead of talking about the distance to P on Rg, I'm going to look at the distance to this new space, to new points at P bar, but restricted to Rg. So maybe here's a picture. So I have lots of points sampled from some probability distribution. Any guesses what the probability distribution is? And I am, yeah, hopeless. But now if you apply this procedure and you lift these points up, you get something that looks like this. And actually what I sampled these points from were two Gaussians, slightly different variances, somewhat moved apart. But in particular, sort of two points, you can think of it as sampling from just taking two points and then perturbing them by Gaussian. And if you think about what is the distance function that this point cloud induces on RG, well, it looks very much like a distance to two points. Noisy, but nonetheless a distance to two points. And so it's desirable to make this, to formalize it, to somehow say something about how this actually works. And we can prove some statements about it in the following model. So imagine I have some ideal space K, and I let, of dimension L, and I let mu K be a volume measure in this space. Now I take a nearby measure in the Wasserstein sense. So for example, I take this mu K and I convolve it with a Gaussian. So now I get a new probability measure mu that sort of spread over the entire space, and then that looks like, well, a Gaussian in this case. And now I draw a point cloud P from this measure mu. So you can think of it alternatively as you pick a point at random on this ideal shape K, and now you perturb it by a Gaussian vector. And in this particular setting where you have a measure from which you're sampling is concentrated on the lower dimensional space, you can prove the following theorem that the distance function that I defined before, this the one that you get by lifting the points into RG plus 1, this is this GPKW, and the distance function to the compact set K, to the ideal thing that you actually want to recover, that we understand, they're close in this sense. So it's the distance between them depends on the Wasserstein distance between the measure mu K on K and the point set, and then something that depends on the dimension of the space. And now, I mean, you can see how this is useful, that you have a construction that you can, you know, it's very simple to execute. You replace one point set by another one. You have a distance function to the new point set, which you can process using all the standard tools, check complexes, RIPS complexes, whatever you like. But now, because the two are close in this L infinity sense, you can now immediately apply all the machinery of persistent homology, anything that comes from stability, with respect to this distance. And maybe it's the easiest to just see it by example. So here's the point set drawn in exactly the way that I described. And here's the sublevel set of this new function. The gray part, forget the black part, is the sublevel set of this function generated by lifting the points into. And you can see already a single sublevel set. I don't need to do persistence. A single sublevel set already recovered something that's going to be equivalent to the underlying, to this figure eight, which is, well, I think is pretty remarkable fact. But also it means that it's useful for the kind of data analysis tasks, particularly so if somebody gives you a point set that's not Hausdorff close to something, but rather sampled in this kind of with this kind of noise, then you can still work with it and reason about it. Now I skipped one bit, namely how did they pick this parameter k? That, you know, I said that for each point I find k nearest neighbors and then I work with respect to them. Well, here persistence can come to our rescue. Isn't that convenient? So what we can do is we can vary this parameter k, just start at 1, 2, 3, and then interpolate in between. And for each one of them, we can compute the persistence diagram. And now all I'm showing is the persistences of the points. So I'm not showing the entire diagram, but only the different persistences. And you can see the pattern emerge immediately, right? So in the beginning, when you're working with just the ordinary distance function, you have lots of noise. But then as you're increasing your k, the noise drops off, and what you're left with are the two persistent classes which correspond exactly the homology of the figure eight. So you can actually use this machinery can help you pick your parameters. Instead of magic, you know, you can look at the distribution, you can see how the parameters vary and pick something with some sort of some reasoning underneath. Make sense? Good. Okay, let me shift gears one more time to tell you very briefly about one more use of persistence that, well, I like. So imagine the following setting. So I showed this picture of where you want to infer some intrinsic structure of a point cloud, but imagine that your points are really shapes, or some kind of a complicated object where it's not so easy to compute the distances between them. For example, if you have two shapes, then a good way to compute distances between them is to use Gromov-Hausdorff distance. So this is a distance that looks at all possible correspondences between the shapes and tries to find the one that minimizes the distortion. So if I take two points in one, two points in the other one that correspond pairwise, then I want this, the pairwise distances to not change by a lot. So this is a sort of famous distance that has great theoretical properties, except that it's very difficult to compute. In fact, it's NP-hard to compute, so not sort of helpful to start with. But you can use persistence diagrams, you can use persistence homology, to bound this distance from below. Particularly if you take one finite metric space and another one, and you compute the persistence diagram of the Ripps filtration in it. This is Ripps X, compute persistence diagram for the filtration on Y, and now you just compute the bottleneck distance between them. This distance gives you a lower bound on the Gromov-Hausdorff distance between X and Y, which is sort of a spiritual, if you will, motivation for, now you can use, you can forget about the Gromov-Hausdorff distance and just use this bottleneck distance or some kind of other distance on the persistence diagrams as a measure of the difference between the shapes, as the distance between, right, the metric that you place on your point cloud if each point is a shape. And there are lots of instantiations of this. In fact, it occurs to me, I should have put it on the slide, Jen Gamble has used this in her work on studying JAWS. She was using distances between persistence diagrams to measure distances between human jaws. That's right. Yeah. Instead, here's a work from a colleague of mine on he's studying chemical compounds, namely molecules. And some of these are known to inhibit cell growth in E. coli. Others are known to inhibit cell growth in humans. And you sort of, most of them are unlabeled, but some actually have these kinds of labels. And he wanted to use machine learning techniques on them and dimensionality reduction techniques on them. But in order to do this, you need a metric. You need a way to compare it, to find the distance between two points. And what he did is he computed for each compound a collection of persistence diagrams. So there was a distance function involved. There were other functions involved that I cannot tell you about because he hasn't published the work yet. But so there was, he computed a collection of persistence diagrams. Now to measure the distance between the compounds, he simply took the sum of squared distances between the diagrams. And so he turned these compounds into metric space. And then he just used the dimensionality reduction technique. The particular one he used is using some commercial software from a company called IASDI. But ISOMAP, he tells me, works just as well. And so he obtained, which you cannot see because of the lights, he obtained...
You can see it actually on those screens.
Oh, you can see it on those screens, perfect. Yeah. He obtained, so this is what you're looking at, is it's the same graph, except that on the left, the points are colored. So each point is really a cluster of points in the space of compounds. And each cluster is colored by how concentrated, how many points in that cluster inhibit cell growth in E. coli on the left and humans on the right. And, well, if you stare at these for a while, it's actually pretty remarkable because, first of all, the points are clustered together, the ones that inhibit cell growth, for example, in E. coli, which suggests that if you're looking for new points, it's a very natural place to look is around nearby already known clusters, which is, you know, rather helpful result. And two, the points that inhibit cell growth in E. coli and in humans lie in different parts of the space, which means that if you're trying to kill E. coli and not the human, you have some praying chance of doing so. And of course, you can find many more applications. I mean, the point that you can use the distances between persistence diagrams to create these proxy metrics on shapes or on some kind of complicated functions that you cannot compare directly is useful.
How do they get the data on these things?
These are already existing 3D shapes. So he has coordinates of the atoms. It's a database of chemical compounds, which is maybe NIH provides. I forget where exactly you got it from.
And these are point clouds?
So each one is, no, I think you literally have atoms. So you have coordinates of the atoms and the identification of the atom. So that's your input is geometry, really. Right? I should point out, this is an excuse, that Tony used Dionysus, a software of mine, to compute persistence diagrams and distances
nice
between
plug.
Them. And so can you. Yeah. I'm glad you like this. Huh? Okay, so I have 10 minutes left for about 20 minutes of slides, so let's see what happens. I want to tell you a little bit about sort of things I've been doing more recently at the Berkeley Lab. And I've been talking so far mostly about distance functions. But of course, you can apply persistence on these kinds of topological ideas to lots of other functions. And there are, when you deal with natural phenomena, there are lots of functions that appear very naturally. You can, in cosmology, people like to think about the densities of galaxies in the universe. In combustion, people study, you know, the rate of fuel consumption, which is as a way to describe a flame. In studying materials, people think about the energies and so forth. And in all these cases, persistence and even just zero-dimensional persistence, so maxima, captures interesting information. So we saw for elevation function on Earth, persistent maxima captures, you know, Everest, Kilimanjaro, you know, prominent mountains. When you look at the density of particles in the universe, you find clusters of them, and in astrophysics they're called halos, and they're quite interesting objects. So this, by the way, is a picture of a possible universe. It's the density of galaxies in a simulation of a universe. When you look at grayscale images of cells, persistent maxima corresponds to actually nuclei of cells. When you look at the distance function, as I already mentioned, you can find the persistent maxima. They really show you pockets inside the material, so you can use it for visualization. So here's an example. I give you a shape like this. It's hard to make anything out, not just because it's a 2D image, but even if I let you rotate it, it's just too many spheres in there. But if I compute a persistence diagram, I can now interrogate, what does this point correspond to? Well, it corresponds to some kind of a large empty sphere that fits inside, because I'm looking at the distance function, right? And which means that there's a pocket inside. If I look at another point, it corresponds to another large pocket inside. And so you can get a sense for what your material really, what the empty space inside the material looks like. But it's desirable to be able to answer various queries about these kinds of functions. So for example, computational cosmologists, when they compute the simulation of the universe, then they arrive at, you know, present time, they would like to be able to compare the simulations to the observations. Now, how do you compare simulations to the observations? I mean, they're not going to, of course, match. But what you really want to look at is some kind of statistical properties. What is the distribution of heavy clusters of galaxies in the universe? Have we captured it with the simulation, or have we not? Similarly, if you're looking at you're studying combustion, you may want to ask, where is my flame? Which means really you want to, for example, pick a point in your space, and you want to look at the level set of this point, so meaning the component of the level set of this point. But the thing is, you want to be able to do this. These data sets are large. So cosmologists, the simulations that cosmologists have, an average size one has billion values in it, so 8 gigabytes, and they go up to, you know, half a terabyte per time step, right? Similar in combustion simulations, you have very large data sets. And so you can't really do this on a single processor. You want to be able to parallelize this kind of computation. So this creates rather unique challenges because, I mean, imagine that I've taken my data set, I've divided it between the processors. Now I pick a point on one processor, and I ask you, report to me the components of the level set, the portions of the level set that contain this point. So now imagine that I'm the processor U. I really am asking you to report these four guys, which I just connected locally, but not report this guy, right? So this is not sort of a trivial task. In particular, you don't want to just start walking around and labeling everything, because this will take you quite a while. And the structures that turn out to be very helpful in answering both of these questions are merge trees, which are intimately sort of very closely related to persistence diagrams. So now instead of keeping track of just when classes die and when they're born, I also keep track of how they merge together. So as I sweep from the bottom up, I'm building up this tree where when two things merge together, I record this information in the tree rather than just cutting it off. And if I keep going, they merge together and I get this kind of a tree. And so if you wanted to recover a persistence diagram, actually, in fact, if somebody asked you to compute the persistence diagram, this would be the way to do it. First to compute this tree, and then to cut it up and record this information as a point of the persistence diagram. And so now if you perturb the function, then the wrinkles correspond to short branches in the tree. And you can compute this using Kraskal's algorithm. So now the question is how to do this in parallel. Now there is about a 10-year-old approach that's sort of the obvious thing, right? You take your domain, you divide it into lots of blocks, you compute the merge tree on each one of the little blocks, and then you start merging them in pairs. You merge two of them together, then you merge the merge trees together, and so forth, to get the full merge tree for the entire domain. very natural procedure. But there is a problem with it, namely that this reduction is top heavy. So if I give you a small data set, if I give you 100 cube data set, this works great. But now if I give you a 1,000 cube data set, something like cosmology, or 4,000 cube, I mean something large, this fails simply because, you know, as you're going higher and higher in this reduction, you lose more and more processors, but you get a bigger and bigger tree. And this is sort of doesn't really work in practice. And so what I claim is that this is a wrong goal to pursue. Instead of computing the full tree, what you really want is a tree that's distributed among all the processors, because you really want to be able to analyze it, not just compute it. And so what we introduced is this what we call a local global representation. That each processor, instead of computing the full tree, each processor tries to compute how its local data fits into the global tree. Because this turns out, as we'll see in a second, is helpful for the analysis. So if I'm a processor responsible for these two vertices, then I really want to know that the component of this vertex merges with the component of this vertex, which in turn merges with the component of this vertex, and so forth. In particular, I don't care about all the little wrinkles that appear along the way. So maybe here's a picture. Here's a full merge tree, and I imagine that it's the data is divided between four processors, which are color coded. And now the red processor stores detailed information about its vertices, plus some extra global information about how these fit into the global tree. All right, so the red guy merges with these little vertices merge with the green, merge with the yellow, merge with the blue, I guess, right? And then similarly, the blue guy stores some smaller portion of the tree, green guy stores some smaller portion of the tree, yellow, and so forth. And now what is great about this representation, and you can, well, one, you can compute it efficiently, but two, now if I ask you the kinds of queries that I put up earlier, where I ask you what is the volume of the component that contains some point all the processors need to be able to answer, then it's a very simple query. So the processor responsible for this point X, it simply broadcasts to everybody what are the components that contain me, that contain this point, because it knows this full information in this tree. And then all the other processors can independently find whether they have points that contribute to these components. And so after this initial broadcast, there is no more communication necessary, which is highly so. So this representation, its real point is to distribute information in a way where you can answer these kinds of queries without communication. Similarly, this question of I pick a point, and now tell me the level set component that describe the level set component that contains this point. Well, same story here. You can actually compute the information about super level set and sub level set components that contain it, broadcast it, and then everybody can answer this compute their contribution. So the processor U can compute its contribution without any communication. This works great in practice. In fact, it scales almost perfectly as you use more and more processors, which is exactly what you want. Whereas, for comparison, here is a scaling for Visit. This is a state-of-the-art visualization system. And as you use more processors, it actually gets slower. And precisely because what it tries to do is it tries to go around and label everything together. Similarly, the point is that this representation, you can compute it a lot faster than the particular scales compared to the old representation. OK, I think I'm running out of time, so let me just summarize what I have told you today together. If you're the one message that you should all take away from this is that if you're working with scalar functions, and you all are working with scalar functions whether you realize it or not, persistence is a very useful idea. It will surely tell you something about your underlying phenomena that you haven't discovered before. It captures features in your functions. It doesn't ask you for any parameters. It just shows you the picture across all scales at once. If you apply it to point clouds, you can infer homology, you can compute parameterizations, find maps into circles, you can deal with general models of noise. You can use persistence diagrams as metrics for studying your data. And there's a lot more. I've barely sort of skimmed through a few of my favorite examples of where persistence is useful. On this note, let me thank you for your time and attention.
We have time for some questions. Any questions? I have a question. If you could go back a couple slides, please.
Sure. How far back?
Right here. Yeah. So I didn't quite get. So what kind of information? I understand the global, the local global goal that you're trying to, but what kind of information, like those big circles, for instance, that the green is sharing with,
right, so
with I can't see the color
yellow,
very well here,
yeah.
Brown or whatever that is. Yeah.
Yeah. So you can think of this as a, so think of what is the underlying function. So there is a minimum here, a saddle, a minimum, a saddle,
right,
and so forth. So what this really tells me is that there is a component here that was started by the green vertex that got merged with the component started somewhere else. So yellow is on a different processor by a vertex that sits on an entirely different processor. So this information, this is what it tells me, that the component that one of my vertices started, this vertex of green, at some point, namely here, merges with the vertex on an entirely different processor. And now it really is part of the component. If you identify each component by the minimum that started it, then really, after this function value, I now belong to a component that's remote. Which means that if I get a query from somewhere else that says, what do you contribute at this function value to this component, I know that actually I contribute these two vertices. So
but you don't necessarily store at that point specific information. So at some point you're going to have to kind of fuse all these things together, right, to kind of get the global picture, right?
Well, that's the beauty. I never have to actually combine them. I only combine the information that I need to answer a query. So if I need to answer the level set query, I combine some information, just the local information about the level set components, but I never have to fuse the entire tree together. I just report the level set. If I want to compute, you know, statistics of how many heavy objects I have, I compute, you know, where are my heavy objects, how heavy they are, which is, you know, just instead of the entire tree, it's a number per vertex, right?
Right.
And then I report this, I combine this somehow together. You know.
But this reminds me of union find.
So the merge trees are, of course, computed using union find.
Okay.
The Kraskal's algorithm. So if I ask you to do this, you will use Kraskal's algorithm.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So
okay,
this is straight up union find. But the question is, what do you do now when it's distributed?
So there is no literature on parallelizing union find.
There is literature on parallelizing union find, but not like this. Not quite like this.
But you need communication between the processor to compute that.
To compute, but the amount of communication is substantially less than to compute the full object, which is why, you know, the computation scales in the first place.
What is the information that is being shared when you have to find out that this is merging with the component in another processor?
Sorry, what is being shared?
So if you find out that some of the data in this processor is merging with the data in another processor at a particular scale.
Yeah.
Don't you need to know all the points over there to find it?
No, that's during the computation of the tree or
no,
during the analysis?
During the computation.
During the computation of the tree, you only need to figure out what they share on their boundaries. So if I have a tree up to this level, you know, on this domain versus a tree on this domain, I only need to exchange information about their shared boundary. I don't need to communicate the full trees, which is where a lot of the speed up comes from.
And how do we compute that shared boundary?
So this depends on the representation of data. If you just have, you know, if you have a grid, just a regular grid, then you can divide it between the processors like an oak tree or something,
so
and then you know this. That's right. I mean, usually this comes from some other code that already has decided how the domain is divided for you, and then you sort of do what you can.
When you were using the distance between persistent diagrams to give a lower bound on the Gromov-Hausdorff distance, what sort of distance were you using there? Bottleneck?
That was the bottleneck distance, yeah.
Does the Wassenstein improve it? And what are the
differences? You tell me. I don't have an answer. No. So Wassenstein distance is a lot more useful for applications for this kind of measuring distances between the diagrams because it's much more sensitive.
Right.
Because the bottleneck distance just looks at what is the worst
biggest
case. Whereas Wassenstein takes the entire distribution into account.
It's expensive, too.
And has anyone, you know, shown other sort of distances when you have a cutoff and you only look at, you know, the pairwise distances between like significant barcodes, let's say. Has that been done? I know there is one that compares like L1 distances instead of L infinity distances, but not for the significant ones. I'm just shooting out there. I'm not sure. I'm just asking.
Right. For the bottleneck distance, I mean you could compute the bottleneck distance between them. But then you should be willing to accept an error that is based on how far you cut off your diagram.
Right.
Beyond that, I don't know of anything. Yeah. But yeah, it would be of course desirable to only depend on the large parts. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Okay, if not, let's thank our speaker.